DL, I know you'll be rushing down to Hampden for the second half. It might just be a friendly, but a big night in store.
Yeah, both of us heading down there, Gordon, to see the second 45, cheering on our national side. And after a disappointing result, I thought the performance, you know, was absolute terrific for long spells of the game, but obviously goals count. Looking to bounce back tonight. I think the Tartan Army, everybody inside Hampden, positive, looking for a good victory. Start to get that good feeling back again.
Yep, listen, Scotland gave us a lot of highs, a lot of lows. Under Steve Clark, there's been, let's just say, a little bit more highs than lows. But, you know, Saturday's probably one of the weirdest games of football I've ever seen. The amount of positives you can take away from it for Scotland. But the facts don't lie, that's 16 without a win now, and I'm sure they'll want to, you know, take this last warm-up game before the World Cup and try and get back to winning ways.
Right, come on then. 01419511025. What do you think tonight? Are you heading along to the game, first and foremost? It would be nice to hear from you if you were on the car or the bus or the train or whatever it was, making your way to Hampden. You never know. Maybe it's the first time. Maybe you're going along for the first time or taking a youngster along for the first time, or maybe you're a battle-hardened veteran heading along to international football matches. So if you're heading along, why not give us a call? Let us know what you're expecting, even if you're not and you're settling down to watch it. What are you thinking tonight then? Predict the team, if you like. How many changes would you make? How many changes do you think Steve Clark will make? Because, of course, you want a bit of experimentation maybe, but a six-game winless run. So I'm sure Steve Clark, well, he did. He said as much, he's prioritising a victory tonight. So what do you think the team will look like? Should Lauren Shanklin stay in? Should Lewis Ferguson be given the nod from the beginning? Do we need to take another look at Craig Gordon, given how little football he's played in the last year and a bit? Are you changing something else in the back line or the midfield? You tell us. 01419511025. Give us a call right now if you can, especially if you're heading along to Hampden. But regardless of where you're watching it, what are you expecting tonight? Who plays? Who doesn't? A few interesting questions to answer.
Yeah, you know, everyone going along tonight will be interested to see what his starting 11 will be. Will he make a lot of changes, Gordon? We've got the international friendlies to, you know, a big squad is to give some people opportunity, guys that are playing very well, i.e. Lewis Ferguson's the one that comes to the top of the list with Bologna. Will he change the goalkeeper? He come in for a bit of criticism, which I find quite surprising. And then you look up front, does Shanklin get another go at it? I think the important thing for us tonight is, as much as it's a friendly, I think we need a result.
Yeah.
Right. And I hate saying that, because friendlies are there for a reason. They're there to give people an opportunity. They're there to try things, whether it be different systems, different patterns they play, whatever it may be. He's brought four goalkeepers with him in the squad. But I think if you're a Scotland manager tonight, you're thinking, most important thing is not be who plays, it's getting a result.
Well, who do you think will play? I'm not really that bothered about what Gordon DL thinks, no offence, but no, I want to know what you think on the phones. 01419511025. Did you enjoy the international break, Andy Halliday?
I did.
I've always had this theory, so now you're on board. Motherwell can't ruin your weekend if they're not playing.
No, exactly. Listen, after a poor result against Aberdeen the week before, I think any player will tell you that it's probably they don't want the international break that weekend.
But came at the
wrong
time.
I can't tell any lies. A couple of days off was nice. Recharge the batteries. I went away to Cameron House for a couple of days, which was lovely.
I went to a caravan. He goes to Cameron. It just shows you the difference.
There are levels to this game.
Exactly.
I know it would have been wilder at the two weekends, but I seen a couple of fellow professionals out there as well. Had a nice wee chat, nice wee coffee as well. But it was nice.
Are they remaining nameless?
They'll remain
just in case they weren't meant to be there.
Just in case they were there with the wrong people.
Right, exactly. I don't know.
They should give me caravan.
I was going to say, I don't know what you're laughing at. Anyway, enough about that. It's a bit early for us to be getting you in trouble. 01419511025. Andrew McLean is at Hampden. What's happening tonight, Andrew? What are we expecting?
Yeah, all pretty quiet at the moment, as you'd imagine, but there will be a big crowd packing in here because there is that excitement every game now, edging Scotland closer to Euro 2024. It is quite exciting to think that after today's game, there will only be two matches for Scotland left before the tournament, but you know Steve Clark won't be looking that far ahead at all. Six games without a win as it stands. There's the obvious caveat of, you know, some of those games being against England, France, Spain, the Netherlands as well, but you definitely don't want to be heading into a tournament on the back of a winless run. Steve Clark asked the question yesterday what he would prefer out of a win and a big performance. He said he'd take the win but is confident that they'll be able to marry the two together tonight against Northern Ireland. They're obviously not of the quality of some of the teams I mentioned earlier on, but they do make matches tricky. If you look at their last qualifying campaign that they just finished, five of their defeats were just by a 1-0 scoreline. So they do manage to stop teams from racking up goals. They did finish their campaign with a 2-0 win at home to Denmark as well, which was a very good result for them. Maybe it does beg the question, as you guys talked about, what does Steve Clark do with this game? How does he approach it? Does Lawrence Shanklin get another chance to lead the line tonight? Will we see a switch in midfield? Daz was mentioning Lewis Ferguson. Does he get the chance to start tonight after his impressive form over in Italy? The goalkeeping situation, an interesting one as well. Four of them in the squad. It was only Angus Gunn that got some game time on Friday night. I think a lot of eyes will turn to Craig Gordon. Isn't playing domestically, but will he be given his chance to show what he can do and potentially try and grab one of those three goalkeeping spots going into the tournament? I'll give you the team news from Hampden as soon as it drops.
Until then, though, you get to pick. You get to decide. You get to predict who should and shouldn't, or who will and will not play in the mind of you, and then maybe try and second guess Stevie Clark as well. Who knows, maybe there was going to be wholesale changes, maybe Friday night changes things. I think Stevie Clark said yesterday one fewer change than he was planning on in light of Friday. Does Friday change things heading into tonight for you?
I think it does. I think it does, because I think that as much as Steve Clark's his own man, he's come in, you know, the team's come in for a little bit of criticism, especially the run of defeats and obviously losing four goals. He knows how important it is tonight to get a result, so I don't think there'll be many changes. Me personally, I look at, for instance, the front line. Big question mark, would Shanklin play again? Nobody's a bigger fan than Shanklin than me, but I think we're a better outfit when Dykes is up front, because I think it allows their midfield to get beyond, go and support. And I'm not saying Shanklin can't do that, but I just think Dykes, especially at Hampden, is a bigger threat.
It's going to be interesting, Andy. As we said, it's quite often you're looking at friendlies and maybe you would prioritise performance. Mm-hmm. Tonight, Stevie Clark's admitted if he had to lean in one direction, which you don't, you can obviously hope for both, but if he had to lean in one direction, he would just go for a win above anything else.
Yeah, definitely. I think a win's massive tonight. I really do, and I think that's strange when you're talking about an international friendly and a build up towards a major tournament. But I just think that, you know, six games without a win, it's just not pretty reading. And I do think, you know, winning's infectious. It can build confidence and leading up to the World Cup, that's what you're after.
From one Andy to another, this one's on the phone. Are you on the same track, Andy? You think just sort of win is the priority tonight?
Yeah, I pretty much came on the echo. It's basically exactly what you're all saying. It's been too long since we've won. We seem to be kind of riding on this high because we managed to qualify for the Euros. You know, the kind of the standard way, not like through any back entrances or anything like that. But when you look at it, yeah, I know we've played some tough opposition, fair enough, but we've not won a game since September, you know, early September when we beat Cyprus. So we really kind of do need to get back to winning ways to kind of build confidence within the team. And I know we do have a couple of friendlies in June. That's still, you know, it's quite a wee while away, and I know Gibraltar, most people would say that's a gimme, but really we need to kind of start performing against teams that the quality they would be expecting to be coming up against, you know. I just think it's pivotal that we win tonight and that we continue with the next two matches before we go back to competitive.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you go through those six, right? I mean, Georgia away, if you might need to have a draw like that at some point in a qualification campaign. I don't think there's any shame in that in isolation, especially when you've kind of sewn the group up already. Similarly, you draw with Norway at home to round off a campaign that you've already qualified for. In isolation, I don't think there's really anything wrong with that either. Then you get on to the real top opposition that we've played in friendlies.
England, France, Spain.
And then the Netherlands. Individually, there's no shame in losing them either. But all of a sudden, Andy makes this is not to get away from. When you get to six winless games, it doesn't really matter the opposition. You just need to get back in that.
The most disappointing thing about that, you can look at all the results and all the teams we've played. I feel sorry for Steve Clark and the squad, because I think everybody will be in the same page as me. For about 75 minutes, we played some outstanding football. And I'm not saying that the Dutch are the best team in the world, but they're ranked up there, what, six or something, FIFA. So, on their own patch, the amount of chances we created, some of the play was brilliant, and I know at the end of the day it's all about a result and we go away with a 4-0 defeat. And I think that's what piles a little bit of pressure on tonight's game. I do think we'll have enough tonight. I think we'll step up to that. I know the lads would probably be hurt with a little bit of criticism, because they'll look at the overall campaign and say, look, we've been terrific, we qualified, it's friendlies, it's there for to, you know, try different things. But I think a little bit of criticism will spur them on to a result tonight.
Well, I'll tell you, it's Steve Clark's fault that there's criticism, because he's exceeded his expectations since he's came in the job, and now everyone's expecting Scotland. To put into context, like you said, there's been four losses in the last six. In the 21 games beforehand, Scotland only lost three games. So he's done a remarkable job against top opposition as well, the likes of Denmark and Spain beforehand. But it's like he says, he's raised the bar now and we want to sort of kick on, although we're playing top positions. Listen, we've been in these games. France, maybe not so much. There was periods of the game it was good, but you know, the Spain game away, we were in it for large parts. England and Holland. But you know, he's almost a victim of his own success, that now we're expecting us to kick on to the next level. And like you said, I echo that. I thought Scotland were superb against Holland. I thought they were arguably one of the best I've seen them outside maybe Denmark.
I suppose it's the nature of it, though. It's just pure arithmetic. If you play like that for 70 minutes and lose 1-0, fine. Mm. You know, you naturally can lean into the positives a bit more. Once it becomes four, it's harder for some people to remember or care about the first 70 minutes when you lose four.
Yeah, it's all about the result. And also let's not paper over the cracks. It could have been probably more than four at the end, because they opened us up a right few times. But I think there was a lot of positives. And I keep coming back to it. Friendlies are there to have, you know, players in the squad, give them an opportunity. Don't judge them because of... The one person I felt sorry for was Shankly, because everybody, the only thing they spoke about was his miss. If you look at, for instance, McTominay, I would imagine McTominay and the Euros, if he gets that chance again, he'll put it in the back of the net.
The header.
Yeah, I think it was Ralston from the ball in from Ralston. So I thought there was, as much as there was a lot of negatives with the last sort of a 15-20 minutes with the goals and the chances we gave up, I just thought, as Andy said there, some of the football was, especially the Midland Park, was absolutely the best I've seen.
With that in mind, Andy, on the line, would you expect a lot of changes tonight, or the fact that a win is desperately needed, might it just end up being quite similar to Friday?
See, I would stick to the core that's been doing the job. I understand what Dale's saying there about friendlies are just like the game's just giving opportunities to other players, but you've also got to remember the international games aren't week in, week out, so you've also kind of got to keep the momentum going. And I think that we really need to get back to that, you know, because we were doing, like you said, we were doing well. We hadn't lost in a long time, and we'd only lost like a few matches and we're over 20. And I think that you need that, especially when you're going into a big club, because we don't get these. Like, I mean, what was the second Euros and since 96? So we don't. There's no guarantees that we're going to qualify for every tournament. So I suppose, after, you know, Holland, good teams are going to do that. They're going to, like, for me, I had a conversation with one of my pals recently. We were talking about Barcelona back in the day, under Pep Guardiola, when they were very strict with a tiki-taka football. But that's what good football teams do is they can maybe, I know they scored in the 40s, but they could go for a long period of time without scoring, and it seeming like, you know, the game's open. And then as soon as they see as soon as the legs start to tire and those little pockets open up, then they punish you. And then when we got punished 4-0, and, you know, maybe against, as you say, like, you know, from how the game looked and how we played, that maybe the scoreline maybe could have been less, or maybe it could have been worse, you know, towards the end. But I think that, yeah, well, I guess with the games coming up, they are a bit more, if you like it or not. You know, the Netherlands, that's obviously playing against France and that.
Yeah, I suppose that does bring its own pressure tonight, in its support. Well, it is. It's a much more winnable fixture and raises the expectation. Thanks to Andy. I want to squeeze one more in before the travel. So let's bring in Chris and Darnley. What are your thoughts ahead of tonight, Chris?
Hi, Gordon, Andy. Thanks for taking the call.
Pleasure, Chris.
I think there is a balancing act to be done by Steve Clarke tonight. He's got a job in his hands. I think he does have to try different things, but he also has to instill confidence in the team, which I think comes with wins. I think, as Gordon said earlier, we're 0 wins from 6 now. I personally think a win and a good performance tonight are both prerequisites for a good start to the Euros. And that said, I'll maybe contradict myself slightly and say I'd like to see Shankland start tonight and see what he can offer.
And is that just in light of, you know, he did enough the other night, and you know, you think he needs more of a chance, basically, to show what he can do?
Yeah, I think he did do enough the other night. I thought he was unlucky the other night. I think Gordon Dale has maybe alluded to this before, but I think he was slightly unlucky. It's a high-pressure situation. The guy hasn't had a lot of exposure to football in the national team, and I just don't think we've seen enough of him, really, to judge.
This is where I think it's genuinely difficult for Steve Clarke, because there's so many competing schools of thought, and they all sound good in their own right. Give Lauren Shankland another go. You know, he did well the other night. We know what Dykes and Adams can do. They got us here, so we don't really need to take a look at them. But by the same token, they're all there. They're all in the squad. Shankland started the other night. Adams came on. Dykes hasn't had any football yet. He's not in a domestic team that's absolutely flying. He seems to do his best stuff for Scotland. So although we are focused on Lauren Shankland, and understandably, Lyndon Dykes will be saying, well, I want to play, and Steve Clarke might want to look at him. So it isn't easy, I don't think, to find that balance that Chris mentioned.
I think because of the pressure, it shouldn't be really pressure, but we have to get a result tonight. I think he'll go back, for me, leading the line for Scotland with the players round about from our mid-layer part, which is so strong, our wide areas where we're getting up and down the pitch. And I think if Andy Robertson can get some decent balls in, I thought he'd get into brilliant positions on Friday, but unusually for Andy Robertson, I thought his final delivery wasn't up to scratch as normal. I think he'll go with Dykes tonight. I think he'll look at Dykes leading the line. I think that Dykes in a Scotland strip is a completely different player from a club player. I'm not saying he's the greatest player in the world. We're all agreeing. I think Shankland will play a massive part in the Euros for Scotland, right? But I think just now it'll be, if everybody's fit, coming off the bench.
An old teammate of yours, what would you do tonight?
I would like to see Lawrence Shankland still lead the line for a couple of reasons, to be honest. But number one, I thought his performance merited another game. I think a lot of the chat going into, you know, Lawrence Shankland's inclusion for Scotland is, yep, we know he's probably the best finisher in the Scotland jersey, but can he add that overall play and all-round game that Lyndon Dykes or Che Adams does? And then you look at the Holland performance, it was kind of flipped, because I thought his overall performance was outstanding. His link-up play was great, ran the channels well. I thought he dealt with both centre-halves really well. But then it was the finishing that actually let him down. But I love what Steve Clarke said when he referenced his finish. He says when you watch it back, he's so composed. It's not as if he snatches at it. It's a poor effort. He drags it wide. He does everything right, except he put it in the back of the net. He stays composed, bends it around the goal, slightly too high, hits the bar. But for me, he's the man I want us leading the line, the World Cup. So
you've started him, Andy, in the
years? For me, 100%. I think club football has to be relevant, and I just don't think that Lyndon Dykes is in his greatest form. Absolutely, he's been a big player for Scotland. Again, I'd probably say what you're saying about Shankland. I think Dykes has still got a massive part to play in the World Cup. But if I'm picking my team for Germany
he's
right
got
now,
the World Cup already.
I know he's got.
Euros. But if I'm picking my team for Germany right now, Long Shanklin's up front.
Thank you to Chris and Darnley. The good news is, I would suspect, looking at the clock, we will have a starting 11 from Hampden after these.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Hear it, watch it. Thank you. 01951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Andy Halliday and Gordon DL are here building up to kick off at Hampden, so keep those calls coming. We have Andrew McLean there, so we'll give you team news very soon, I would imagine. Archie is on the line, formerly in Sri Lanka, now in Partick. No difference, Archie. How are you?
I'm good, yourself?
Not bad. Was that work? Did you live out there? What was the story?
I can't see it over the phone. Oh. I can tell you it's classified, but I need to show the Clyde
that
I've told you.
Oh, I like that. Archie,
we'll
like
phone you back, Archie. I think we need to know. Do you know
she's like a spy?
I'd love to hear that.
Phone Archie back.
Do you know what? I'd love if it was like a submarine.
I don't trust Gordon DL. He tells everybody.
RGL yeah, keeps everything quiet to half seven.
That's definitely true.
Oh, by the way, because you were the most mysterious guy that I
like
knew.
Archie, yeah. What's you your second name, Archie?
Why? What makes you say submarine?
No, I'm for some reason right now I'm obsessed with submarines. I watched a documentary, Operation Odessa. Have you heard it? Seen it?
No.
Honestly, ever since I'm obsessed with submarines.
Can you confirm or deny if you're involved in submarines, Archie?
Mummy, tell you something. I've got a friend quickly. See, years and years ago, right?
Uh-huh.
I've got a friend called he's dead now, Jim Tate. And Jim Tate used to run a nightclub in Hamilton called Circles. And he actually used to run the chips for a lot of footballers.
Right.
He was friends with James Mortimer. But years ago, when Scotland qualified for the 78 World Cup, right? I'm sure he was joking, saying, "I'm going to rob a submarine to Argentina." And I kid you not. He get letters for all the world for people thinking he was genuinely going to run a submarine.
If you can run one to Germany, Andy Halliday will be on it. Anyway, right. Enough about your mysterious past, Archie. What are you thinking about the team?
I was saying to the boy there that I think that if they drop Lauren Sagnard, I think it'd be really unjust. I think that the boy needs to find his feet in international football first and foremost. He's just sort of finding his feet. He's a great season. I've never been a fan of Dykes. I think Dykes peaked, and I agree with Gordon DL a couple of years ago that he's a different animal when he plays for Scotland. But that was a couple of years ago. He's done nothing in 2 years. He's scored 20 goals in 3 seasons with QPR. I think the team's got a really, really good balance. I watched that game. I thought we played brilliant football. We're a mature team. I think we just need sometimes a wee bit of luck. I think that's what the difficulty is sometimes.
I get maybe latterly, but still within the last qualification campaign, I don't want to get pedantic whether it was just inside 2 years or a year and a half or whatever, but
no,
within the last campaign, Lyndon Dykes was magnificent against Spain at Hampden and scored that important goal away in Norway.
Look, I would be delighted if Lauren Shanklin leads the line. I've no problems whatsoever. I'm not criticising, the decision if he did. But I just think that tonight we need a result. And I think that Steve Clark, I'm talking about Steve Clark here, I think he'll look at someone like Dykes to lead the line because I do agree with you, Gordon. I think Dykes has been terrific for us. I'm not the greatest fan. I don't watch a lot of his club football.
Date-wise, it's a year on Friday is the Spain game at Hampden, which he was really good. He led the line. And then it was obviously the summer in June when he...
Yeah, I think he'll get back to him tonight. I really do. I think there won't be a lot of changes like Andy. And it'll be interesting to see the middle of the park. I thought were brilliant. Billy Gilmore was outstanding.
Well, I'll tell you what, Archie, you've got the perfect opportunity here. You've thrown that one in, and now we'll find out who does play and then get your reaction. Andrew McLean has the team.
Steve Clark has made two changes for this game tonight. Out go Ryan Porteous and Lawrence Shanklin. So it's going to be Liam Cooper coming into that back three, and Lyndon Dykes is the man leading the line. So Angus Gunn continuing in goal. The back three, Jack Hendry, Liam Cooper and Kieran Tierney. Nathan Patterson is the right wing back. It's Andy Robertson as the left wing back. The four central midfielders, John McGinn, Billy Gilmore, Scott McTominay and Ryan Christie, and it's Lyndon Dykes leading the line. The substitutes: Kelly, Clark, Gordon, Ralston, Adams, Porteous, Souter, Armstrong, Shankland, Ferguson, Taylor and McLean.
Well, there you are, Archie. You did not get your wish. You think that's the wrong call tonight?
Yeah, I do. I think, what does that say to the boy? It's as if you... I'll give you your first start. If you don't you don't get great heights, Then you're out. I mean, I think you have to let the boy find his feet. I would have gave him at least two games. I think it's going to knock his confidence. I think it's a really poor decision, and it's one of these sort of knee-jerk decisions. I think it's really poor for his confidence.
Do you think it is that? Do you think it is that though? Because I know we've built it up that way from the outside, but we were alluding to this earlier. He picked three strikers. Lauren Shankland started. Shea Adams replaced him. Is it not entirely possible that it was just always the plan then for Lyndon Dykes to start the next game?
Well, what if Shankland scored a couple of goals on Holland? So would they have dropped him then?
I think it was a game plan. The one, I can understand that, and it's a great argument. As I said, I'm a massive Shankland fan. I think he's absolutely brilliant. The one thing that stands out for me there and baffles me is the goalkeeping situation. He's got four goalkeepers in that squad, mm-hmm. and he's went with the same goalkeeper in both games. I'm a bit surprised with that one, but I'm not surprised that he's went for Dykes tonight. Right, if he'd have went for Shanklin, I'd be over the moon. I think I was with Andy. I think Shanklin was very unlucky with his chance. I thought in the first half particularly, I think he linked up the play very well. I think he'll get better and better. I think he'll be a big player for us in the Euros. He will definitely be there if he's fit. But I just had a feeling that he was going to go for Dykes tonight.
Oh, listen, if we had enough time to predict the team, I was expecting maybe two or three changes. The big ones for me was I thought John Souter would come in, so I'm surprised to hear it's Liam Cooper that's got the nod. And the other one I'm surprised again that he's not playing is Lewis Ferguson. I just think his club level never really had that opportunity in a Scotland shirt. We're just talking about Lauren Shanklin getting his opportunity against Holland. I thought that would be Lewis Ferguson's chance tonight. Don't get me wrong, he's competing in an area of the pitch where we're extremely strong, and I think that four. That sort of box of Christie, McGinn, McTominay and Billy Gilmore are excellent, and they have been. But I just think if you're going to give them an opportunity at some point, I was really surprised it wasn't tonight.
Are you surprised the goalkeeper stayed the same like Gordon Dalziel is, Archie?
I'm not even thinking about him. Do you know what? I just wanted to quickly just put to the pundits. Do you know, think that what I've just said, do you know, think that will really knock Shanklin's confidence when they threw him out of that? I mean, you're away from home and against Holland. Do you not really think that will knock his confidence with dropping him? The team's lost 4-0. I mean, giving you one game, I think that would not. What do they think?
No, listen, I don't think it will knock his confidence. I think there's been that much praise from the manager and his teammates around his performance. I don't think it will be seen as being dropped. It might just be seen as being rotated, and I think that's all it is. Steve Clarke was very vocal in what he thought about Lauren Shankland's performance against Holland. He said he thought he led the line really well, and obviously this is just Steve Clarke wanting to give an opportunity to Lyndon Dykes. For me personally, like I says, and listen, who am I to tell Steve Clarke? He's done a remarkable job for Scotland, but I just think
what you're here for,
exactly. But with him such an emphasis on a result tonight, for me, I would have liked to have seen Lauren Shankland lead the line. But again, I stress, I don't think he'll lose confidence.
I agree with Andy. I think that Steve Clarke's a very good man manager. I think he'll probably have told Shankland. I think he'll have given him all the praise in the world. I don't think he's dropping Shankland, right? I think we need to get away from this. I think he's had a game plan.
Dykes was always playing tonight.
Yeah, because
you don't buy Archie's counter that, if Shankland scores a hat-trick the other night, I still think he's left out.
But by the way, I still think he would go with the same thing. You know what I mean? So I just, the one I keep going back to is the goalkeeper. It baffles me why you got four goalkeepers. And the reason I'm saying that is because Craig Gordon, it was a terrific opportunity. If everybody's talking about he's the one that's going to sneak in and one of the other goalkeepers has got to miss out going to the Euros, he's not had a lot of football. It's a perfect night to give him another 90 minutes under his belt, but he's stuck by Gunn. Is that because Angus Gunn's come in for a little bit of criticism after Friday night?
We spoke about this last night, Andy, and one of the counterpoints, which was fair, I think it was Kenny that made it, was that Angus Gunn's only got 8 Scotland caps. So, that notion that, we know what he can do and he's the number one and he can sit out, maybe that's actually not the case. If Angus Gunn is going to be the number one at the Euros, as I think most people expect him to, do we actually need him to get a bit more experience? We need him to get up to speed with more Scotland caps ultimately.
Yeah, potentially. But
sorry, just quickly, because remember he missed the couple there that Xander Clarke played in, didn't he?
Yeah, but listen, we're talking about two changes. Steve Clarke's went very strong tonight, so he's went with his number one goalie. I don't see a massive issue with that, because like he says, Angus Gunn will be injured. barring any injuries, touch wood, doesn't happen, but Angus Gunn's going to be in goals come Germany and Munich, so I'm not too too disappointed or surprised at that. The biggest surprise was naming the four goals in the squad in the first place. I think everyone was quite shocked when they seen that.
Is that just a man management thing where he might need all of them? And you know, if one of them gets injured, so as an example, say you bin off Liam Kelly or Xander Clark this time, but then Craig Gordon gets injured, and you have to go back to Xander Clark or Liam Kelly in a couple of months and say, "Oh, listen," and you come again. Is it not? Was that not just good management this time? Just pick the four of them. You've got a hard decision to make. You don't need to make it right now. Just make it down the line.
But for me, I think it's made the decision more difficult, because now one of the four knows that they're going to get dropped. Listen, if Craig Gordon never made this squad, he probably felt that, you know what, I'll probably not be in the Euro squad. But I think now he's in the squad, he's thinking, I'll probably get the Euros.
And do you agree he probably will then?
I don't think he will, no. I don't think he will.
You don't think Craig Gordon?
No, if you're still number two at Hearts, I don't think you're getting in the squad.
I agree wholehearted.
I'm not talking about what we think. I'm talking about second guessing Steve Clark. Do you not agree
that makes it harder now? His decision's now harder because he's including them in the squad, especially if you're not going to give him any minutes. If you wanted to call him up and maybe play him for 45 minutes to see, do you know what, can Craig Gordon still play at a national level, which he probably can, if you're not going to do it.
Not if all along you really think you're probably going to take Craig Gordon.
Well, listen, we'll see. For me personally, I don't think Craig Gordon will go to the Euros. That might change. Listen, Hearts might secure third with four games to go, and then Craig Gordon gets the last four games of the season, has a world day, and then that might change. Yeah.
Well, it's either Craig Gordon or Liam Kelly is missing out, because you can't leave out Xander Clark, because he's the number one goalkeeper at Hearts. How can you explain that? You know, so that's a big decision. But I take on board what Andy's saying about Gunn being in their number one goalkeeper. I thought there'd have been a couple of more changes tonight, Gordon. I really did.
I was really surprised Lewis Ferguson's not
there.
Yeah, really, I
think a lot of people would be. But I just think Steve Clark's looked at it and thought, do you know what? That midfield four, the blocky four that you were talking about, were excellent for 70-odd minutes. Yeah. So I'm going with that
we
again.
Want to see Billy Gilmour again, don't we?
Yeah, he was head and shoulders, including Holland's team, the best player on the park for me at the weekend.
Thank you very much to Archie, the international man of mystery, now back in Partick. It was nice to hear from you. Let me tell you about this.
Clyde One Live, celebrating the first 50 years.
Keep your calls coming in, reacting to that team. But more importantly, have you got your tickets to Clyde One Live yet? Because tomorrow is the big day. We're going to announce the final two acts on Bowie at breakfast. Set your alarm, make sure you hear the announcement, and more importantly, buy your tickets at Clyde1.com. The first three acts, of course, were Amy McDonald, Callum Beattie and Emily Sandy, and you can find out the final two tomorrow. Remember, we're taking over the Ovo Hydro on Friday, the 31st of May, and you can get your tickets at Clyde1.com.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard with Col Robert Accident Repair, taking care of your... Clyde One. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon DL and Andy Halliday in the building. Let's bring in Ronnie, who's on the line. How are you, Ronnie?
Very well.
Good. What are you thinking tonight?
To say to Gordon how he thinks that Craig Gordon will be one of the four goalkeepers that's left out. Well, the defence is a wee bit of shambles the last 20 minutes the other night there. They didn't cover a certain glory. Now, maybe Craig Gordon is the final part of the jigsaw with his experience for the back four, because the last 20 minutes they were like an amateur defence. And also, my point with Lauren Shanklin, she's going to the World Cup and start by a distance. I've said that for a long, long time. And after they scored against Georgia and various other things, a lot of people are jumping the bandwagon. To me, Lauren Shanklin is fired in front of Shea Adams, London Dykes. Craig Gordon should be the final piece.
So you'd take Craig Gordon to the Euros. Are you surprised he hasn't played tonight? Do you think that means he's maybe not as close to the Euros as some people say? Or why is Angus Gunn playing tonight, do you think?
If you want to take your best squad, not team, squad, he's going to go there. And if you're looking for experience, he's the man with the experience for me.
But, okay.
In the back of line.
What age is Liam Kelly?
27, 28.
Right. Gunn.
Similar, I think.
Similar.
Xander Clark, slightly older.
Xander Clark. So, you're talking... Ronnie's talking about taking experience. They're three experienced goalkeepers.
But in a Scotland context, obviously, Craig Gordon's the most experienced.
For a cap, right. But,
no, but even across, he's 12 years older than them.
I think Craig Gordon was a terrific goalkeeper and probably still is, right? Just now, what you've got to look at, because we're hearing people saying, oh, you've got to play guys in form, i.e. Shanklin, Ferguson at Bologna, players like that. Craig Gordon hasn't played a lot of football. And I think that's what the stumbling block is here. Now, what I look at that tonight is if you bring Craig Gordon into the squad, and I think it was a good idea, get the four goalkeepers in there, keep everybody nice and tight, make sure there's a good group. But I think if he was looking at further for Craig Gordon in the Euros, there's a perfect opportunity.
So you
at
think?
Home.
So you think the fact that Craig Gordon doesn't start tonight suggests
that he won't be at the Euros?
Or you're less confident now?
Yeah, I think if everybody's fit, I think the three goalkeepers, I think Craig Gordon. Now I'm not saying that's right, but I think Craig Gordon will be the one that misses it.
I agree. I don't think Craig Gordon will go to the Euros. I think it could change. He might break into the Hearts team, which, you know, if Xander Clark again, Touchwood, gets an injury or whatnot, and then that changes the plans. But I think as it stands, like you said, if you're taking a reference of the Euros is tomorrow, I don't think he goes.
So you think that would be a mistake, Ronnie?
Oh, definitely so. The best, most experienced keeper out of the forum. So if you want to do things, go for the best. Take the best way. Craig Gordon will know what he's going to do, never has. Got a bad, bad injury. Same swinging out at half. But as Andy says, he might win the last half a dozen games when the split changes.
Is half a dozen games with Hearts going to push you to Scotland's number one in the Euros?
But again, Ronnie did specify, to be fair, about taking the strongest squad.
See,
I think Craig Gordon's not going to go to the Euros as Scotland's number one, is he?
No.
But it's a question about does he go at all?
Yeah. But look, I like Craig Gordon. I always have. He's been a terrific goalkeeper and still is. Still a lot to offer. But I just think looking at the way Steve Clark operates, I think right now, and it could change, and we all know that, right now I see Craig Gordon as the number four.
Interesting. And another one that Ronnie said again, you know, about Lauren Shankland, miles ahead of Dykes and Adams. I always feel like we get so many calls saying that, so then I provide the counter argument, and it almost sounds like I don't want Lauren Shankland to play, which is honestly not the case. I know people don't care what I think anyway. It's not that. It's just every call we get really is pro Lauren Shankland, so I'm kind of here to keep the debate going. I do feel like the strength of it, you know, the idea that he's miles ahead, or that it's a no-brainer, someone sent a tweet saying he should be like the first name in the team sheet, it can't be at that stage, can it, given
No.
What the other two have done to get us here.
I wouldn't say first name of the team sheet, no. But again, like, I think a big debate is about, you know, hold up play, overall play. Can someone actually tell me that Lyndon Dykes is 100% better than Lauren Shankland? Because I can. I think Lauren Shankland's hold up play is extremely underrated. His ability to take the ball in under pressure. If you're telling me Lyndon Dykes runs the channels better than Lauren Shankland, maybe. But Scotland aren't really that team anymore. I don't think we've been that team for about 2 or 3 years, to be honest with you.
Fair.
So I think the way we play, I think, actually suits Lauren Shankland. And fundamentally, see, if you need a goal, Lauren Shankland's the guy you want as your number nine. And I go back to, you know, when Lee Griffiths was a Scotland player, and then even before when Chris Boyd was a Scotland player, we always seem to know player best finishers. And we play the likes of, this is going to sound disrespectful, but Chris Abalumo, when he played with Scotland, it didn't work out, and people are saying, oh, why not playing with Chris? Again, I think this is the Lauren Shankland appeal for me, and I think everyone can sort of see this year and last year that everyone would agree now his overall play as a striker has improved dramatically over the last couple of seasons, and now I think he suits this Scotland team perfectly.
See, just to go back to a factor that we often overlook when it comes to club football, and therefore we certainly overlook it at international football, because you don't get much time in the training ground, right? I get that. So I get why people would hark back to club form. I'd love to know what happens on the training ground. For all we know...
Oh, I know. I ask all the time.
You nosy. Yeah. You can tell us.
No, then. No, I'll stay. I'll keep the exclusive conversations private.
But as an example, because you've got players operating at very different levels in very different leagues, maybe Lauren Shankland is absolutely lighting up Scotland training, and Steve Clarke in his head knows this week, or thinks, by the way, that, you know, this he's much, much better than I thought previously, having left him out of that Georgia squad and only bringing him in at the last minute. You know, I wonder how much players like Lauren Shankland can do that. We focus on his scoring record at Hearts. For Lyndon Dykes, we're focusing on what he did against Spain last year, what he did against Norway last summer. I wonder how much they're all able to catch the eye in training at a limited time.
I think you've got to catch eye in training, especially in international, because how many times does a manager see you? So you've got to make an impression. And I think that probably knowing Shankland and the finisher he is, I think Steve Clarke might be looking and thinking, oh, this guy knows where the back end is. Look, we might get to the first game against Germany and Lauren Shankland might be leading the line. I've not got a problem with that. I echo everything Andy says. I just look at the way Steve Clarke operates, and I think he looks at, if we played their first game tomorrow against Germany, Dykes would lead the line.
It's like you're saying as well about providing that counter argument for people that are so pro Shankland. I don't want to talk up Lauren Shankland and sound as if I'm being detrimental towards Dykes or Che Adams, because I'm absolutely not. They've both been excellent for Scotland, and I think, listen, I think Steve Clarke's got a brilliant head. I think he's got three very good strikers at his disposal. But I'm here to offer my opinion, and my opinion is, I think he's the best striker we've got. I think he's the best striker on form, club level. And again, I'll echo it, if the Euros tomorrow, I want him leading the line.
Thanks to Ronnie. William is on the line. How are you, William?
All right, Gordon. All right, Andy. All right, Gordon.
Right, William. Hey, William.
Right, snap judgment, William. You don't care who starts up front for Scotland. You want the worst of the three to play.
Yeah, and rubber. No, nobody. They still have no centre forward tonight, to be honest with you, you know.
Yeah, it's still win.
You know, but
the Dazzler's up front tonight, William.
Yeah, don't discount the wee Green and White Army tonight anyway, that's what I'm saying. But all seriousness, boys, I can understand why Steve Clarke's went with Dykes tonight, because I think it'll be a bit more physical than what the likes of Holland game would have been, which I think suited Shankland better than what it would suit Dykes. The back line, Northern Ireland's going to be a wee bit physical. Dykes can throw it about there, you know. But another thing, what about the battle that's going to be tonight between Andy Robertson and Conor Bradley? Like, that's going to be, like, looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to Shay Charles and Millie Park. I'm up against Billy Gilmore, for example. You know, these are good, good young players there, you know, in the middle. So I don't think it's a foregone conclusion tonight, by the way. We are on on beating them our last two. When's the last time Scotland got a win? You know, we went to Romania, got a good result in Romania. We're young boys. Many of the Scottish fans will not know many of their players in Northern Ireland. But I'll tell you what, when they pull on that Northern Ireland shirt, they'll run through a brick wall for Michael O'Neill, and it's been proven before. So this fixture tonight is better than any stupid friendly. There's going to be a bit of pride on the line with a few boys that play in Scotland that's in the Northern Ireland squad. You know, it'd be good to see the young boy coming on months to see how he does from St. Martin and things like that, you know. So I think this is going to be a great friendly with no foregone conclusion. We're going to hear tomorrow, well, the downside of Scotland under Steve Clark after a hammering by Holland and then a wee small 2-1 defeat tonight by the Green Army.
You might be right.
Do you not think William should chap the dressing room door and give that team talk?
I was nearly supporting Northern Ireland after my
bruising.
Never. Football in general can be quite cyclical, especially international football. And we had a Northern Ireland fan last night. You look at them being at the Euros in 2016 and Scotland nowhere to be seen. Like, the cycle's moved. Scotland are in a pretty good place. Northern Ireland are at the start of theirs with young players. But as William mentioned, they don't tend to get beat convincingly ever. It's going to be a tough one, isn't it?
Yeah, they obviously got a positive result against Romania with the 1-1 draw the other night as well. And it's not that you actually look at their squad, it's, you know, you think of Northern Ireland, you think of your Johnny Evans, your Steve Davis, like all these guys are.
That's what I mean, that'll move on.
It's all a young group now. I agree with him with the Roberts and Conor Bradley. That'll be a brilliant matchup to watch. Obviously, Conor Bradley went on loan to Bolton, had an unbelievable season since he's came in at Liverpool. He's done really well. So I think there's sort of duels all over the park that's going to be really interesting. I love the fact he said unbeaten in two, as if that was some massive sample size he's gave us there. But listen, I think it's going to be a really good game. I think it's going to be difficult for Scotland, but I certainly do make the Tartan Army favourites tonight.
Thank you to William. Forget Conor Bradley against Andy Robertson. It could be you against Andy Halliday or Gordon Dalziel if you get involved in this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Beat the Pundit time, 01419511025, and the lines close at 7. Let's hear from you.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard. The headlines. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Gordon DL and Andy Halliday are both here. It's 0141 951 1025. You can tweet us as well at Clyde SSB. Of course, we're talking about the Scotland game tonight. We were sort of predicting teams and picking teams and so on, but we have the team now, so we know that it's only two changes. It's Lyndon Dykes comes in up top and Liam Cooper comes in at the back. So no Lauren Shankland and no Ryan Porteous. Before we get back to that, let's play this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Right, it is Beat the Pundit time, so let's see what we've got tonight. Oh, it's a double team, it's a duo. We've got Finlay and Tony.
It's cheating, isn't it?
No, it's cheating.
No,
cheating,
it's not.
Well, me and Andy.
We'll go together.
You're allowed as many as you can. You'd hold him back. Are you kidding?
No, I wouldn't.
You'd take scores off him.
Well, I'd help Finlay.
Finlay and Tony, how are you?
Tony.
How's it going, guys? Can you hear us?
Hello.
How's it going? All right?
Yeah, good. How are you?
Not bad. What brings you together tonight? You're in the car somewhere, or what's happening?
It's Tony's night tonight. I'm Thursday, and we always listen in. We're just driving to training.
Right. What training?
Pardon?
What training?
Football training.
I know. What team?
Oh, Dumbarton, sorry.
Dumbarton, like, first team?
Yeah.
All right.
Oh, what's your second name?
Say again?
Second names.
Finlay Gray, Tony Wallace. Tony Tavernier, they call him. Tony Tavernier.
Tony Tavernier.
Tony Tavernier. Like,
good win for Dumbarton the weekend.
When current SPFL players phone in.
Double T.
You two could be in trouble.
Oh, we could be in trouble with Tony, right. The Dumbarton lads.
Halliday's the man to beat. Do you want to try and take him down, or do you want an easier task?
No, we want to do
them.
We'll
do
them.
No, because believe me, from my...
Can I be honest with you, Tony and Finlay? I don't want that. I want to keep my record.
Also a shambles from the in here, you two shouting out. Anyway, I'll toss the coin. If it's heads, it's Andy Halliday. If it's tails, it will be Gordon DL. And it is Andy Halliday against Double T
and Finlay.
Honestly, I'm going to be honest, I did not want it tonight.
I tell you what, I hope they wipe you.
You don't mean that.
Mate, I hope you get
right,
done.
Let's give Andy some greatest hits radio to listen to. And that way he can't hear us. Right, guys, I'm going to put 30 seconds on the clock. Just answer as many as you can and pass if you don't know the answer, okay?
Yeah.
Right, let's go. 30 seconds. Which Rangers players get more international caps, Ross McCausland or Abdallah Sima?
Sima.
What number does Matt O'Reilly wear for Celtic?
28.
Steve Clarke was assistant at Newcastle under which manager?
Pass.
What nationality is Dundee's Antonio Portales?
Mexican.
Who's the captain of England's men's team?
Kyle Walker.
Who won Scottish League 2 last year?
Stirling Albion.
Which Euros playoff finalists have won the tournament before?
Portugal.
There we go. Can't believe you two get one of those questions. Sorry to bring back bad memories. Anyway, let's go. Andy Halliday, can you hear us?
Here
we go.
That
was the 30 seconds.
And by the way, they shouldn't be two. They were brilliant.
I don't know how many times I need to explain this. The thing they play is 30 seconds. It doesn't change at any point.
He's a nightmare to sit with, by the way.
I know, twitches and...
Honestly.
Are you ready?
Come on, I've got faith in
you. Come on, let's
go. Don't put him off.
He's got a broken nose in his...
What is up with your nose?
My nose is just killing me. I've got another bang on it today and it's just all blocked.
By the way, two beats together against A2.
I know.
You know what I mean? Beat one, beat two.
You already heard it, so if I point of view, you give me a wee...
Don't you worry.
30 seconds, Andy Halliday. On the clock, your time starts now. Which Rangers players get more international caps, Ross McCausland or Abdallah Sima?
McCausland.
What number does Matt O'Reilly wear for Celtic?
10.
Steve Clarke was assistant at Newcastle under which manager?
Robson.
What nationality is Dundee's Antonio Portales?
Mexico.
Who is captain of England's men's team?
Kane.
Who won Scottish League 2 last year?
Stirling Albion.
Which Euros playoff finalists have won the tournament before?
Italy.
Scottish Championship assist leader Glenn Middleton plays for
Dundee United. Oh, you could have got another one there.
How?
gone rapid. I can't believe. My head was gone at the start, by the way.
I'm sorry,
how bad I had started.
I just choked at how this has made its way into the football language. Assist leader.
Can I say something there, by the way? Right? This isn't an excuse. This is God's honest truth. See the question you asked about the Euro playoff? I couldn't hear it because he's...
I know, he's a
laughing pest, right next to you. Can you hear it?
He's a pest.
Oh, look.
What was it? Something playoff final?
I don't understand that, Andy.
Finley, well, Tony, how do you think it went?
Not great, man.
Oh, Jesus.
You did all right. Let's go.
What was that question again, though?
We'll get to it.
Mexico, not Mexican. So that's not...
Oh, listen, I'm harsh, but I don't know if I can be that harsh.
Rude to it.
Right.
Shocker.
The Ranger... No. Your shocker came right at the start. Yeah. Ross McCausland's got one Northern Ireland cap.
Exactly. Do you know what? I'll be honest. This is obviously no two. I only thought Seema had one or two. I thought McCausland had a couple.
Five to one. So it is Seema and Finlay and Tony go one in front.
Yes.
That's where it ends. It's like a home game for you.
Now I knew that Andy wouldn't get this because he's hopeless with squad numbers.
The worst.
It's 33 though. Finlay and Tony didn't get it either.
33, is it?
There is no closest away.
Never got that.
Steve Clark was assistant at Newcastle under Ruud Gullit. None of you got it.
That's hard though, innit?
Yeah, I think so. I would love to take it off him, but I need to give him Mexico, I'm afraid. So Antonio Portales is Mexican 2-1. To
no, I never got
1-1.
That's the first one I've got.
I know, so it's 2-1 to Finlay and Tony. They
got
that.
They get Mexican? Sorry.
Oh, well done.
However, Finlay and Tony, Harry Kane is the England captain.
You never got that, Finlay and Tony.
They went Kyle Walker.
The last team they played, Kyle Walker was sorted.
Is it Declan Rice tonight? I think.
I don't think they know who Dumbarton's captain is. Never.
It's not. Who is that? It's me.
Oh dear. I have to say, I felt for the guys here because it was as you know, these things are random. To open old wounds, Stirling Albion won League Two last year. They certainly knew it. And Andy Halliday knew it as well. Which Euro playoff finalists have won the tournament before? I do think that's a confusing question. It's as in, see the playoffs that are on just now. Which one of the teams in that has won the Euros?
Greece. Poland, Greece. Do you know what? I never heard the question, but I wouldn't have got it right.
So it's 3-3.
I wouldn't have got it right.
It's 3-3. But Andy Halliday sneaked one more question in.
What was
it? It's so easy as well.
Dundee United.
Middleton.
Glenn Middleton plays for which club? Dundee United.
Yes! It was a good game, though.
And you wonder why you play with Dumbarton, boys.
Exactly. You'll need to pull out of training tonight. Anyway, send our regards to the rest of the team. Thanks for calling, guys.
Cheers,
guys. You're the best, lads. Good win for them at the weekend.
I like that bravery because you stick your neck out there. You're on your way to training. Yeah. The rest of the team will have heard it.
Especially their twos.
I'm so relieved. See that winning? See that feeling of winning? Ugly is the best.
We can have no Dumbarton beating Motherwell on here.
No. I was gone at the start.
Mate, listen.
Gone.
I'm going to tell you right. Without a word of a lie here, take this on board. It's only a game. It's only
it's much more than that.
He's in the office practicing for last night.
He listens to last night's.
Unbelievable! I've never seen anybody doing that.
I do that after every show. Like I listen back to the show in general. So I love. Know what happens? You'll love this. So I listen back to the show and see the teaser for the night before. I'll give it to the Motherwell dressing room the next day. Genuinely,
I know
you to everyone.
And then
because I know the answers,
it's
easy.
I think that's about the closest we've come to you losing.
Yeah, that was a poor performance, but we got there at the end. Do you know what, as well? The fact they never got Kane.
I know.
I've got lucky there.
I'll tell you what, it's not often you go through the first three questions without any.
Oh, my head was gone. I'll be honest, it was gone.
Anyway, 01419511025. We are building up to the game tonight. You can call about something else if you want. There's not loads else out there, it has to be said. But you never know, the guys started talking about submarines and all sorts of random nonsense. So you can certainly mix it up. I actually got a message from Gordon Strachan. Not that
the
one.
Gordon Strachan.
To say that he's just come back from a 201-day patrol and turns on the radio to hear us talking about submarines. So he's been away on 201 days.
That's what fascinates me. I never knew, like, something mad. Like, if you go and that's it, you kind of come out for X amount or whatever.
Obviously.
It is. I know, but
what do you mean?
I don't mean like the people.
Just, like,
I don't mean the people
the
that are actually traveling in the submarine. But see, if you're doing like, I'm kind of lost in what I'm talking about just now.
But what's the alternative? You think like after a few days you can just go open the door?
Go to shops or something.
No.
Obviously,
I'll put you in touch with this guy and he can give you more information. Because I don't know that much, but I know that you can't just nip out after a few days.
Do you think, to all the listeners out there, watch Operation Odessa if you like submarines.
Do you think the last day is the longest? 201. Why just,
I know, just round up, nice round
just
number.
Make it 200.
Maybe they just got lost. 205. Take a bit longer to get back.
Take a 205.
Aye, but what?
Do you think they're 201 days on?
202 days off. Half a year on, half a year off.
Anyway, let's go back to Hampden if we can, because we spoke a bit with the caller before the news. It was a Northern Ireland fan. We know there's a lot of familiar names in that squad. So who gets the nod for Michael O'Neill's side tonight? Andrew McLean. Oh, he's there, sort of. He's just nipped away for a pie.
Oh, aye.
Quite right.
100%.
To be fair, I would usually send him I'd give him a heads up and say I'm maybe going to come back to you here, and I didn't.
I told you, my next life.
And it is a long way.
In my next life, I want to come back as Andrew McLean.
Why?
I just think he's got some job.
Because he gets to go about
all the European tips and that. Brilliant.
He's only going to Hampden. Listen, you've not seen the budget that they send him on in here.
I don't know.
No.
Oh, they sleep in a blanket. No.
Are they like,
oh, mate, you do not want to go on the trips.
I'm surprised at that.
Well, that's before I had the displeasure of sharing the, I got a
that's
little
what you
taste
used to
of that.
Enjoy it?
Obviously, great.
Brilliant. Some of the stadiums you get to go in that football you watch.
I would take
the going, by the way, bad news for you this week. Where am I? You're at Fir Park. Oh no.
Some football.
Can I leave early?
Right. Andrew McLean, I could tell he was there. He just maybe had his headset off. Can you hear us now, Andrew? Yes, let's do it.
Yes, I can.
Northern
hear
Ireland
you.
Team, who's given the nod?
Yeah, just looking at the Northern Ireland team at the moment, it's going to be Bailey Peacock-Farrell who starts in goal for them today. It looks as if it's probably going to be a back five for them as well. Brody Spencer, who Motherwell fans will know as the right wing back, Trey Hume as the left wing back. Dan Ballard, Ian Toll and Paddy McNair are the back three. Ali McCann and Shea Charles in midfield. I think it's going to be Isaac Price and then Conor Bradley either side of Jamie Reid. Conor Bradley, of course, making his name at Liverpool, has been very impressive this season. I think he's just been nominated for Premier League Young Player of the Year as well. One of the brightest talents to come out of Northern Ireland for a long time. Normally plays as a right back or a right wing back, but could well be played in a more advanced role for them tonight. Just looking at the substitutes bench, some names that people will know as well from Scottish football. Conor Hazard is there, of course, the former Celtic goalkeeper. Conor McMenamin at St Mirren. Caelan Boyd-Munce as well at St Mirren. Kyle McGuinness has spent some time, sorry, Josh McGuinness, of course, has spent some time in Scottish football as well.
Yeah, a few stick out, take your pick.
That Conor Bradley one's the most surprising, probably playing a more advanced role. I think William was the earlier caller that was looking forward to seeing them match up against each other, a wing back role. It's even closer now because one of them was playing directly in front of Andy Robertson. So, no, I think that's the one that stood out. Obviously, good to see some of the Scottish contingent there in the bench, and obviously, Exon Johnson, Alan McCann in the midfield.
Yeah, I could have done. I thought Caelan Boyd-Munce, Conor McMenamin, cousins that play for St Mirren and an international setup as well. I thought maybe one of them. Brody Spencer was excellent for Motherwell in the first half of the season, and by all accounts has kicked on quite a bit since going back to Huddersfield. So,
Young side,
yeah,
enthusiastic, Gordon. They'll be well organised. Michael O'Neill's
that's such a patronising word, isn't it?
What's
in football
that?
Terms, enthusiastic.
Yeah,
I mean, I'd like to think so.
Yeah, but I think
it's like bare minimum requirement.
Look, I would be very disappointed if we don't win tonight, I've got to say, especially with the starting 11. I think Steve Clark's taking that into consideration, but there'll be no mugs, but I think we should go and win that.
Well, this is the strange thing, Andy, right? And I'll definitely caveat it because I'm scarred for years of Scotland disappointments, but it's not often that we play any of the other home nations, doesn't matter whether it's Northern Ireland or Wales or whoever, and you would look at their starting 11 and say none of them would get in Scotland's. Here comes the next bit, though. International football doesn't always work like that.
No.
And sometimes teams are more than the sum of their parts, and we know that they've got great character still under Michael O'Neill and have dug out some good results, or if they lose, they don't lose heavily. So that would be the bit that would give you the confidence if you were matching them up on paper. And then the worry, if you like, or the bit that brings you back down to earth, is that it just doesn't always work that way.
No, they've got a lot of young talent. I think, no, you're quite right in saying we don't play the home nations regularly. I think this is the first meeting since 2015, which was obviously a long time ago. Their teams could put a change since then, so is Scotland's. So it's going to be a difficult game. I don't
Scotland
think there's
winner that night.
Christoph Berra.
He's watched it. He's seen it.
So I think, listen, it's going to be a difficult game. They've got a manager that's been very successful for the international team in the past. And another interesting one is this his last international game with the links to Aberdeen. Mm,
that's true. It could be Gordon DL. Sorry. Michael O'Neill.
Yeah.
He didn't even listen to that. Nah, did he?
Nah. What did we say?
I've got to apologise.
What was distracting you there?
I was thinking, and I'll tell you after the break, because I need to run out that door quite.
Who's Michael O'Neill linked with?
Aberdeen.
Well done. Never in doubt, Dazzler.
Yeah, he was reported at St Mirren watching Aberdeen under when Neil Warnock was there, I think.
I mean, he did say, like, I just happened to go to keep an eye on Conor McMenamin and Caelan Boyle.
Yeah, but he's a very good manager. He's obviously likes club football, but you just wonder if Aberdeen is his next move. I don't really know about that.
Billy Gilmore, I noticed it's his 25th cap
tonight. How old is Billy Gilmore now?
He must be about 22, I think.
He's well on his way to hitting the 100 cap mark the time of his career. I don't want to wish it away too early, but I mean, I think we've all seen it since that sort of that breakthrough year he had at Chelsea when he first started coming through, that what a talent we had on our hands. You always felt he was going to be a big player for Scotland for years to come. He's had, you know, disappointments along the way, most notably obviously that loan move at Norwich, and people started to write him off. But since he's been to Brighton, I mean, I've watched Brighton, are one of my favourite teams in the Premier League to watch, to be honest. I've watched plenty of them this year and he's been outstanding. And again, listen, I reiterate what I said against Holland at the weekend. I thought he was, honestly, I thought he was levels above players on the pitch.
Have you seen the documentary that the Scottish FA made about him at Brighton? It's not just about him at Brighton, it's about his career,
and they ask his family and his dad. I have seen it.
The thing that struck me was just how good the facilities look at Brighton. That's all I'm interested in, really.
I've
played there a couple of times.
Does Motherwell have its own built in spa?
I tell you what, do Brighton have a dartboard? Because Motherwell do.
I remember this, right, like, so as part of a day job, go around some of the clubs in the summer and try and get a bit of a look behind the scenes. You know, what something a bit different. What are you doing away from training, and try and get a bit of personality in most of the clubs? And they still do. It's all about darts, right? Yeah. And talking about the levels, as you say, the Scottish clubs, have you seen our dartboard? And they all are playing darts. And then somebody told me, and I can't remember which club it was, I think it was one of the lowest. It was either like Sheffield United, I think it was. Have got a fully functioning golf simulator at their training ground.
No way.
Or one of the clubs down there, I can't remember which one, we like the green that moves and stuff like that.
No.
And I just thought about Andy and his pals.
You'd sign for them.
Delighted because
for half the wages elsewhere, wouldn't you?
I would sign for them and never play a game.
Aye.
A football.
Aye.
Just a simulator. In my day, I don't know if it's still got it, the table tennis, so that would used to be.
No, that what was the first club I had that? Middlesbrough was big for it. We had that down there, but I agree with Gordon. Darts is certainly overtook the change in
the Who's the top darts player at Fir Park?
Me, genuinely. Me.
Are you just saying that?
No, I'm being serious.
Oh, best at beat the pundit, best at darts, anything else?
To be fair, we had a very competitive bet.
Sorry, I couldn't resist.
No, we had a very competitive start school at Hearts. There's some good players, but
were you the best stand as well?
To be honest, no.
Who was?
Craig Halkett was very good.
Any Motherwell players who want to take issue with that statement, you know where we are. Anyway, we'll take more of your calls next. Clyde One Super
Thank you.
calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Andy Halliday and Gordon DL are here. 0141 951 1025 or Twitter at Clyde SSB. Getting ever closer to kickoff at Hampden, 20 minutes away, as we see what Steve Clark's side can come up with tonight. We'll go back there before kickoff, but whilst you get your calls in, and please do, let me give you this.
The full-time teaser with Universal Interiors East Kilbride, where their corners are made to measure, with wardrobes built and installed from just £8.95.
Bob in Shettleston has provided this tonight. Thank you to Bob. And it's on that usual email address, fulltime@clyde1.com. That is where you submit your full-time teaser. And I've never had the joy, but I can imagine the sense of satisfaction when your question gets read out and you hear the pundits struggling to come up with your answers. So that's what we can offer if you want to get involved. Fulltime@clyde1.com. Very topical, this. I like it. Can you name the last 11? It's quite a long list. We'll see how you get on. The last 11 Northern Irish capped players who've played in a Scottish Cup final.
Woo-hoo. Davis.
Steve Davis.
Stephen Davis. Yes.
Yeah. Ali McCann.
Yes, Ali McCann plays tonight as well. Yep.
McGuinness as well?
No.
No?
No, not Josh McGuinness, no.
Scottish Cup final, yeah.
I think how far are we going back here?
I won't tell you that just
Lafferty?
Yet. No, actually.
Yeah, I was thinking we're not going that far back to that.
No, so we're pretty much within the last, well, we are within the last 10 years. All 11 answers are within the last 10 years.
Dean
I don't
Shields.
Mind telling you that.
Dean
yes.
Shields, great shout.
Okay. That's a good start. You want to go one more guess?
I will go Niall McGinn.
Yes, okay, we'll leave it there. That's four down, seven to get. And we're looking for the last 11 capped Northern Irish players who've played in a Scottish Cup final. So we can get back to it. And remember, fulltime@clyde1.com to submit your question. That is the aim of the game on the full-time teaser. Get your calls in then. What are you thinking tonight? Are you disappointed not to see more of Lauren Shanklin from the start? Are you disappointed not to see a change in goal? Would you have liked to see Lewis Ferguson? I'll just keep talking while these two children whisper to each other about the full-time teaser. Would you like to see any of those players play tonight, or anyone else? Or are you happy enough that Steve Clark stayed mostly with the group that played on Friday night? Do let us know right now if you can. 01419511025. Let's hear from the Scotland camp then, whilst you get your calls in, and please do, because Steve Clark is expecting another tough test against Northern Ireland this evening.
Young team, progressive team. Michael's quite good at talking his team down a little bit, but they're very competitive. They don't lose many games by a big margin. They beat Denmark at Windsor Park in their last qualifying game 2-0. We got a little bit excited when we beat Denmark here at Hampden 2-0. They went to Romania, which is a tough place to go. Went there with a young side, got a good 1-1 draw. Performed really well. So we expect a tough challenge. It'll be a tough game for us. It's why we took it. We want a tough challenge. We always want tough games. So one we look forward to.
And let's hear from Scott McTominay, so often the main man for Scotland in recent times. He says recent results have hurt, but he's quite happy with long spells that they've had in those matches.
Yeah, they are sore points to take, but if you actually look at the game, Holland, we were firmly in that game. We had four or five clear-cut chances that we could score. France, we started really, really well. We had a lot of control of the ball. Three or four set pieces was the thing that killed us. And then the England game was probably the blip where we were probably most disappointed in terms of our performance and the levels that we know we can hit. They weren't there on that night. And for us, they're the ones that we have to look back on with most disappointment. But I feel like the other games that we've had against the so-called the top eight teams in the world, I don't think we've been too bad. We've got such a good group in terms of the camaraderie and the banter and the jokes and stuff like that, that whenever we do go onto the pitch, there's trust in each other and we know that your mate's going to have you back in tough moments. And I feel like throughout the big games that we've played, the competitive games that we've had that in abundance, to be honest.
This week is the 1 year anniversary, and I remember it well, of calls to this show saying, I don't know if Scott McTominay should play these games coming up because he's not getting a look in for Man United, and we need to play players in form. And you know, we need guys that are playing regularly for their club and so on. A year ago, now look at him.
I also remember some calls saying if he does play, it has to be at centre half. After a couple of the games that he played at centre back, I remember that obviously that famous Serbia game. But listen, he's been the best player of the campaign for us. Listen, I think John McGinn ever so often is that big player in big moments, but I think that last campaign, I thought Scott McTominay was outstanding. That performance against Spain with the two goals at Hampden, but throughout the full campaign, he's just been that go-to guy. He's been the guy that's sort of popping up the areas and scoring big goals at big times as well. And listen, if we're going to have a good Euros, which everyone's hoping we will, I'm sure he's going to be a big part of why.
Well, he's massive for us, absolutely massive. It's incredible because he's one of these players that can play, if he had to, at the back. I don't think it's his favourite position. He can sit as a midfielder and then you can let him go and get onto things and score goals. He's doing it with Man United as well. It's all saying, isn't it? You don't play with Man United if you're a bad player. He's been terrific. He just needed the right fit for me. You know, he needed the right sort of a balance. I think with the midfield, the way we are just now, I think he's got that. He looks very comfortable in the formation as well. And he's been absolutely terrific for us.
Yeah, and you know, it's now, he goes peaks and troughs a bit with Man United in terms of involvement. But his last game there would have been that Liverpool game, goal and assist.
Listen, I don't claim to watch Man United every week, but I feel as if any time I do watch Man U in big games, he's the guy that's popping up in big moments. The games, the team struck me, but I remember last month when he comes on in the 88th minute, 1-0 down, injury time, scores a goal in the last minute to win them the game 2-1. Obviously the Liverpool game, I wouldn't be surprised if you could check up. I'm sure he's still scored 4 or 5 goals for Man United this season, even though he's probably only got scorer. Maybe.
I think he's the top scorer still, no?
Is he?
With Manchester United?
No, I can't be sure. But the point remains, it seems as if he's never had that real opportunity to get a run the team, but any time he does play, he's coming up with big moments. I'd be surprised if he was a top goal scorer, though.
Yeah, probably making that up, to be fair. But he's now such a key part, isn't he, Gordon? Go back to the last qualification campaign and playing right centre-back, as Andy says.
Yeah, and to be fair, didn't let us down. He's magnificent at stepping out with the ball and playing passes, but we've got good options in the defence now, and it allows him to go and play his natural position, the position he knows so well, and he's lucky enough to have terrific players round about him in there. You know, Gilmore, as you talk about, if he makes runs in the passing, you've got McGinn in there, it's playing at a top level as well. McGregor's a fantastic footballer. Christie, I think, was magnificent the other night there. So he's in a good spot just now, and he's adding so much to his game for us.
Joint top league scorer. Seven in the Premier League, and no one's got more. Hoyland's got seven. McTominay's got seven. Go. Rashford's got seven.
I mean, that sort of proves my point, but even then I'm shocked. I never thought it was anywhere near seven. I thought it was maybe 4 or 5 seven, and then a couple
seven,
in the league.
Seven in the league and 9 in all competitions.
I mean, it just shows you. Again, he's probably got half the appearances other boys that are playing in the midfield, but it seems as if he's a go-to guy for them in big moments at certain times. But you know, just to touch on what Adazza was saying there, like, I think I look at that Scotland back three over the last few games and that midfield four as a box. I think they all complement so well. I think they all bring different attributes that really suit. And I think it's two really, really competitive areas in the field for Scotland.
Right, I did say you could call up about things other than Scotland. That's what Ian's done. Ian, we are very pushed for time before kick-off, so make it snappy if we can. My apologies.
Okay, just quickly. Regarding Brendan Rodgers, Thursday, Brendan will win his case. Guaranteed.
Guaranteed?
The lawyers from outside Scotland, listen, I didn't want to come on because in case I get banned, I'm not going to get banned, but it's the most biased football association in world football. What up against?
Of them all?
I'm going to tell you, Andy, good evening anyway, Gordon and Andy.
Hi.
Alex Cochran put his head into Yang's feet, into his boot. Never even touched him. A yellow card, correct decision. The handball was it Tomoki?
Yeah.
Never a penalty kick. But the penalty kick, as I've said to you before, with Ida, was never a penalty. But the game.
Well, the most biased association in the world wouldn't have gave Celtic that penalty then if it wasn't a penalty,
no,
would they?
No. Listen to what I'm saying to you, Gordon.
I'm listening. I listen to every bit of it.
Yeah. John Beaton reversed two decisions. But their decisions wouldn't have been spoke about if either scores a penalty kick that wasn't a penalty. I've already said it was not a penalty. But what I'm saying is, we're going to open up a can of worms on Thursday. Celtic Football Club are going to open a can of worms up on Thursday. Because it's happening too often. Other clubs are getting done out of money and going to get relegated for decisions by these officials.
But you've just said that Celtic also benefited from a decision that was wrong. You said that, not me.
But listen to what I'm saying, Gordon. They never scored the penalty kick. You wouldn't be, if they score the penalty kick, you're not talking about the other two decisions, because the dynamic of the game changes completely.
I'm kind of lost a bit about the outcome of the penalty.
I'll be honest, I'm a wee bit confused as well, because you were saying about up and down the country where teams are going to get relegated in terms of decisions. I don't know how that falls on the bias being solely towards Celtic, but if you listen to the show after the game against Hearts, we were all in agreement that the decisions made on the day were poor decisions, no doubt about it. In terms of the appeal on Thursday, I don't think he will win it, because it's in the law that you can't state bias or incompetence towards referees. He literally used that exact word, incompetence. So I'm sure it's something that Brendan Rodgers will wish he could retract now, because he is going to probably not win the appeal. He's going to miss two games.
I've always said, Gordon, once it gets to this stage, I don't really know. I don't feel the need to predict it. I get obviously where Andy's coming from. It says it black and white in the rules, so I can see why people wouldn't think he will. But Ian might know something we don't. Maybe Celtic are lawyered up. Maybe they've got an excellent case. Maybe they go and present it and maybe he wins. No idea, because that's the bit that's all behind closed doors. It's all sort of legal speak, arguments that are probably above our heads. And we'll see. Maybe Celtic will win that appeal.
Yeah, I agree with what you're saying. The fact that I think that obviously they will be lawyered up. They will go in there and put forward a terrific case for their manager. You know, but the rules are there. I'm not buying into Ian's biased situation here. But I thought on the day, I agree with Andy, I thought there was a few poor decisions. But I don't know if it's a heated moment, because Brendan Rodgers is not normally like that. He's very composed, knows what he's doing. But he's put himself in a little bit of trouble. And you say, Gordon, we can't second guess it until we know exactly what the outcome is.
Thursday night will be good fun, that's an absolute guarantee. But we're nearly there. Kickoff at Hampden is coming next.
Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Thank you.
Glasgow and the West. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Kickoff is just minutes away at Hampden. The national anthem's just about completed. We'll go to Andrew McLean for a final readout of those teams and a flavour of the pre-match atmosphere. Gordon and Andy are chomping at the bit. They both say they're heading straight down to the game afterwards. So let's go back to Andrew McLean because kickoff's fast approaching.
Yeah, a big roar there as O'Flower of Scotland finish. The Scotland players arm in arm taking that one in along with the crowd. It really has packed out here in Hampden as well. A big crowd for this friendly match. I'm sure a lot of this crowd really are starting to feel that Euro 2024 fever. After today, just two games left to go until the big tournament, and you can hear the fans in full voice already. The tracksuit tops just coming off for both teams. They've shaken hands, ready to get their official team photos as well. But it will certainly be an interesting game. There is a big travelling support as well from Northern Ireland. Many will have come across the water. Many, I think, will have come from more local areas as well to come and see this game. But there should be a good atmosphere for this game tonight. Of course, it is a game that Steve Clarke, Scotland are expected to win. Steve Clarke saying that he'd take a win over a performance, but if he, you know, he feels that both are very much possible in this game tonight. It is a pretty simple task for Scotland, though. End that winless run. Six games without a win. Yes, very tough teams they have played in that run. The likes of England, France, Spain, the Netherlands as well. But Scotland need to start building that momentum ahead of Euro 2024 with, as I said, just three games to go until the tournament. I'll give you a recap of that Scotland team. Two changes for Steve Clarke today. Ryan Porteous drops out as well as Lawrence Shankland. It's going to be Liam Cooper coming into the back three. Lyndon Dykes leading the line. Angus Gunn continues in goal for Scotland today. The back three, Jack Hendry, Liam Cooper, Kieran Tierney. The right wing back is Nathan Patterson. The left wing back, captain Andy Robertson. Then that box in midfield, Billy Gilmore, Scott McTominay, Ryan Christie and John McGinn. Lyndon Dykes up top. Plenty of players for Steve Clarke to turn to, which I'm sure he will throughout this game from the bench. Three goalkeepers, Kelly, Clarke, Gordon. Will we see any of them during this game? And then the outfield players, Ralston, Adams, Porteous, Souter, Armstrong, Shanklin, Ferguson, Taylor and McLean. John McGinn is standing over the ball. The Scotland team are in that new kit that they will be wearing at the tournament in the summer, and we are ready to get underway at Hampden.
Go on then, what's it going to end tonight? Get your match predictions in, you two.
You want me to go first?
If you want.
I think we'll win 3-0.
Wow, big praise or big prediction. Andy Halliday.
Got Scotland 2, Northern Ireland 1.
Did your mics just keep going on and off there?
Yeah, they did, yeah. I think it'll be a lot closer than what people are anticipating.
Yeah, I always think these 2-1. Games just tend to be, don't they, for whatever reason. But anyway, we are underway. We'll keep you up to speed on anything that happens in the early stages. I wonder, just because we're going to be off air by then, I know the game's only just underway, but to look forward a bit, will we see a goalkeeping change at some point? If we're taking four, does one of them at least get a half, or how does that work?
I will be surprised if Gunn plays 90 minutes. But look, I was surprised tonight. I thought he would have
3:30s.
I said last week, four goalkeepers, two games, four halves, everybody's happy.
Billy Gilmore gave the ball away. That's not what funnily enough, as good as he was the other night, he actually did give it away a couple of times in the first minute or two, and then he just warms up and he gets going. But anyway, just a minute on the clock as Scotland look to try and get a bit of a grip on it. It's just so fast and frantic, isn't it, Andy?
Yeah,
that's kind of what you knew it would be. It's a bit more like a cliche, like a cup tie, I suppose.
Well, I think you could see straight for kickoff that Scotland's kickoff and Northern Ireland almost sank back into a shape. But as soon as they win it, they're looking to try and counter Scotland quickly. Obviously, that came for a sort of loose pass in the middle of the pitch, and Billy Gilmore getting nabbed and they're attacking their numbers. But you can see in these sort of scenarios here that Northern Ireland are quite happy for Scotland to have the ball and break down what looks as if it is a straight 5-4-1 almost formation.
Yeah, it could be a difficult one, a bit of a slog trying to unpick that lock, but hopefully Scotland can do it early on and that changes things. How are you getting on with this team?
Oh, flying. Oh, absolutely flying.
He's nailed it.
Right, so we were looking for 11 Northern Ireland. Hold on, John McGinn just gets one blocked. Had a similar chance the other night where he tried to curl it towards the back post. He actually scored in that goal, I think, didn't he, against Israel with a very similar opportunity, but it wasn't to be on that occasion. Right, the last 11 Northern Ireland internationals who've played in a Scottish Cup final: Stephen Davis, Ali McCann, Niall McGinn and Dean Shields.
Billy McKay?
Yes.
Aaron Hughes?
Most recently.
Definitely looked at my sheet.
Aaron Hughes isn't one.
No, Billy McKay. Liam Boyce?
Yes.
Michael Smith?
Yes.
Conor Hazard.
They were all teammates of yours who played exactly in all of these games. Conor Hazard.
His ex-Hearts pals.
Conor Hazard was in goal for Celtic though in that game, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was. The one behind he was in goals for Northern Ireland the last game, so that's one of our
many we waiting for.
Three?
Have
three
we?
More, yeah. I'm afraid so.
Mate, we're a bit stumped now. I reckon there's an Arsene Johnson one in there.
Yes. And Gordon, your favourite theory?
There's, I know who it is.
There's even more goals.
I was trying to keep you've it for glory.
Got, you've got Conor Hazard, but
I've got it.
Go on then.
I was hoping for a.
Oh, hurry up.
Trevor Carson.
You've still got two more to get. So how can we build up suspense when you've got three left?
I know, but I was waiting for Andy because I thought Andy was
going. Is Johnson one?
Okay.
Jason Kelly on Irish now?
No.
Who is the St. Johnson one then?
It's St. Johnson the first time. Not the Callum Davidson team. It's the Tommy Wright team.
Dave McKay, Anderson, Murray Davison, Dave.
Who was the goalie?
Who was the goalie?
So it was just before. That's before Xander Clark. Who was Xander Clark sort of number two
to? Oh,
who was it?
McManus? Oh, McMahon? It's something like that. Alan Manus.
Right, one to get. Right, Scotland are on the attack here. Just going to try and go for goal himself. Maybe a bit selfish. Ryan Christie, you don't mind that,
no,
do you?
No, I don't mind that. On his favourite left
was
foot
outside him, though.
It's Billy Gilmore that picks the ball up in the middle of the park. He Lyndon just Dykes, goes straight through.
Slide Lyndon Dykes.
Nah, I think he's got to go for
that. It's a really poor shot.
It's terrible, but I think he's quite entitled to have a go.
I've said it for a long time. I like that about Ryan Christie. He's not scared to have an effort put outside the box. I think in games like this as well, when you're playing against a lower block, I think you've got somebody the quality has. His left foot to have a dig at the edge of the box.
I think his hat, not for everyone, I don't try to patronise and say like, because I'm not pretending I watch loads of Bournemouth either, but I do feel like there's a bit of a slight out of sight, out of mind with Ryan Christie, because like Gilmore's like a superstar in the making for the Scotland fans. You know about like Robertson and Tierney and obviously McGinn and McTominay. So it feels like people maybe not quite appreciating how good a season Ryan Christie's having for Bournemouth.
Listen, I've watched a fair bit and he's always done really well, but again, you see the reports, they're raving about him this season. I actually noticed in a couple of the games he played, it was the game I watched recently, I think it might have been Tottenham, but he was playing deeper. He was playing as a number six. But yeah, listen, we've known since he was at Inverness, Aberdeen and Celtic, he's got a lot of quality. I think he's a perfect example of his club form has played him into the team as of now, but it'll be interesting to see what happens when Callum McGregor
comes back.
That's
what I was going to say, because Callum McGregor, again, I don't know, by his high standards, maybe not having an outstanding Celtic season, Gordon, but he has been unbelievable for Scotland. You think about that Spain game and that full campaign, he plays all the time under Steve Clarke.
Yeah, and that partnership with Gilmore in the middle of the park, it's so important for us. It's a great, look, I think Steve Clarke's a great headache, because we're talking about tonight, debating about four goalkeepers, we're talking about Lewis Ferguson, and I totally agree with Andy, he's been absolutely brilliant. Shanklin has been brilliant. None of them on the pitch tonight. We're missing guys like Hickey. Hanley's not there. McKenna's not there. So I think it's a terrific. I think as much as there's a bit of negativity going about the Scotland squad just now because of recent results, I still think we're in real, real good shape.
Lon Shanklin comes on and scores tonight.
Do you think so?
Yep.
Guaranteed.
Yep, guaranteed.
I suppose it's true what you say, Gordon. It's relative negativity because it's a nice position to be underperforming in your pre-tournament friendlies, if that makes sense. Because the alternative we've had over the years is we don't have pre-tournament friendlies because we don't get there. Don't get me wrong. That doesn't mean you just rest on it and think all the hard work's done and anything else is a bonus, because that's not the way to go about it. But it's like I say, it's a different type of negativity we used to have.
But I think the lads deserve a little bit of slack, Gordon. We're all the same. Andy touched on a great point at the beginning of the show. It's Steve Clarke's fault. He set such a high bar, and everybody's expecting us just to go out there. We played a team that's ranked sixth in the world.
That stat, don't you? Yeah. You've looked that up in the last few days.
And a team that's full of quality, And the players that are playing at the level they're playing at, probably one of the best centre-halves in Europe as well, in their own patch, I may add. And I thought that at times we were absolutely brilliant. So, look, we've came a long, long way. And it'll be interesting to see how we do tonight. But I think we've started positive.
Yeah, Scotland are really, really dominating this. Not managed to create like clear-cut chances yet, because Northern Ireland have got loads of men back and are making it tough. But Scotland doing really well in possession. Scott McTominay wins a free kick. Do we have a free kick specialist? Because this is right in...
Tavernier.
He's no playing. No.
I think it will be Ryan Christie, I'd imagine.
Scott McTominay?
Maybe.
Billy Gilmour?
I don't think I've ever seen Billy Gilmour take
I think Christie all day long here.
Suits the right
foot. McTominay or Christie all day long.
Right, give me one more. You need only one more in the teaser. The last 11 Northern Irish capped internationals to play in a Scottish Cup final. Billy Mackay, Stephen Davis, Liam Boyce, Ali McCann, Michael Smith, Conor Hazard, Trevor Carson, Niall McGinn, Dean Shields, Alan Manus.
I've absolutely no chance.
Do you want to know what's sneaky about this one? Do you know what part of Northern Ireland he's from? Paisley.
England. Oh, there you go.
So he's capped by Northern Ireland, but I think he's from Paisley.
St Johnson.
According to his Wikipedia.
Played in a Scottish Cup final or won the Scottish Cup?
No, I think losing team. He played with Dundee United, St Johnson, Partick Thistle.
Paul Payton.
Oh, brilliant, Andy.
Here we go. Free kick comes to nothing, and whatever does happen tonight, we will look back on it tomorrow. Scotland dominating early on, but no breakthrough yet. Thanks to Andy, thanks to Gordon, Marvin Bartley, and Simon Donnelly tomorrow night from 6. So make sure you join us. And enjoy the rest of your night.
Go!